In this video, we'll take our first look at the aggregate expenditure function, examine its components, and their determinants. We'll conclude with an introduction to the diagram, which will be explored in further detail in the following video. The aggregate expenditure approach to equilibrium is based on the theory that an economy will be in equilibrium if expenditure equals income. We reference the circular flow model to better understand what's meant by that. If expenditure equals income, it means that planned spending is equal to the income earned by the factors of production. If that is the case, then the economy is in equilibrium. However, if spending is less than income, then firms will cut production. If spending exceeds income, then firms will increase production. Let's start off with the aggregate expenditure function, and we'll return to the idea of equilibrium towards the end of the video. Aggregate expenditure is the total level of spending that takes place within an economy for a given time period, usually a year. In the short run, we hold the price level constant. This is different to our aggregate demand and aggregate supply model, where we view real GDP against the price level. In the aggregate expenditure model, also called the Keynesian aggregate expenditure model, we plot expenditure against income. Aggregate expenditure is equal to consumption spending plus investment plus government spending plus the value of net exports. Let's look at each of these components and the determinants that influence them. The first one we're going to look at is consumption. Simply put, consumption is household spending on final goods and services. Consumption is the only component that we do not hold fixed. Individual consumption alters with income. The formula for the consumption function is as listed: C equals A plus BY. A represents autonomous spending. This is consumption that would take place irrespective of income. If an individual had no income, they would still need to spend money to afford basic needs like food, shelter, and clothing. They would fund this either through spending their existing savings, borrowing money, or from other sources. To that autonomous spending, we add some amount that changes as income rises. B represents the marginal propensity to consume. This is the additional amount of consumption that occurs when disposable income rises. And Y represents disposable or after-tax income. To clarify, A is spending irrespective of income, whereas BY is spending dependent on income. The consumption function expresses the relationship between aggregate expenditure and income, or real GDP. If we plot it graphically, the y-intercept would be at the positive value of A. The slope of the consumption function is determined by the marginal propensity to consume, or variable B. Now that we have established our consumption function, we should also take a look at the savings function. The savings function looks at how savings change with income and is expressed as the formula S equals negative A plus SY. A here also represents autonomous spending. If income were zero, this would be dissavings, hence the negative sign. S represents the marginal propensity to save. This is the additional amount of savings that occurs when disposable income rises. Y represents disposable or after-tax income. The saving function has a negative y-intercept because of the dissavings element at zero income. The money spent when income is zero is either dissavings or borrowing, which results in a negative level of savings when no income is earned. The slope of the savings function is determined by the marginal propensity to save, or the variable S. Now, beyond income, there are several other factors that would influence the level of consumption. First up is wealth. If households feel wealthier, they are more likely to spend. When house prices appreciate, homeowners may feel wealthier and make more purchases as opposed to if their home value had not appreciated. Interest rates are the cost of borrowing and the reward for saving. If interest rates fall, consumption is likely to increase as borrowing becomes cheaper, saving less attractive, and repaying debt with an adjustable rate of interest becomes easier. Third, if consumer expectations are quite positive, consumption is likely to be higher. If consumers fear a recession or experience a pandemic, their spending habits are likely to be more conservative as they plan for uncertainty. The more credit that is available, the more opportunities there are to borrow and spend. If there is an increase in the availability of credit, spending should increase. And finally, when wealth is redistributed from higher income earners to lower income earners, consumption is likely to increase. This is because people on lower incomes tend to have a higher marginal propensity to consume than those with higher incomes. The second component of aggregate expenditure is investment, which is planned business spending for the year. We assume that businesses forecast their spending for the year and that it is a fixed amount of spending for that time frame. There are several factors that influence the level of investment in an economy. First up is the level of consumer demand. The higher it is, the greater likelihood of increased investment. Similarly to consumers, a low interest rate will encourage firms to borrow and expand production. Low interest rate environments mean cheaper borrowing costs and lower debt repayments, as well as a level of consumption that will be higher than in a high interest rate environment. If business expectations are positive, businesses will spend more than they would have in uncertain economic times. And government policy can encourage or discourage investment. If policy is favorable to firms, such as the deregulation of industry, it is likely that investment will increase. If government policy is not favorable to firms, such as an increased corporation tax, they may reduce investment. If technology helps firms become more profitable, it will drive investment. Similarly, the cost of capital goods impacts the profitability of firms, so a lower cost for capital goods will also result in greater investment. Since we assume planned investment is fixed and not responsive to changes in income, we represent investment as a straight line. The assumption that investment is not responsive to income is a big simplification, but an essential assumption of the model. Third is government spending, which includes spending by all levels of government, local, regional, and national. Government spending is influenced by the tax revenues the government collects, what their political priorities are, government policy, and changing demographics. Government spending can be higher with more tax revenues collected. Lower levels of tax revenue will constrain government spending. If the country's priorities are to expand the military or improve schools, increased spending may result. However, if the government is more concerned about the rising national debt, then austerity measures may be taken and spending cut. Also, if government policy results in greater need for spending, then government expenditure will rise. If a country experiences a high birth rate or has an aging population, there will be necessary increases in spending to address the various needs that would result. A country with a high birth rate will have to provide adequate schooling for the growing generation. An aging population will strain the healthcare and pension system, which may result in greater government spending. Here, we also assume that government spending is fixed for the time period and not responsive to changes in national income. Therefore, G is also represented on this diagram by a straight line. And finally, we come to net exports. The value of net exports is determined by subtracting the spending on imports from the revenue earned from the sale of exports. Net exports are determined by several key factors. If the domestic economy is performing well, it may result in greater imports and thus reduce the value of net exports. When trading partners are performing well economically, our exports to their countries may rise, which would cause net exports to rise in value. The depreciation in the domestic currency's exchange rate will make imports more expensive and exports cheaper. The currency appreciation will cause imports to be relatively cheaper and exports relatively more expensive to foreign buyers. If the quality of exported goods and services improves, then the quantity of exported goods and services should rise as well. Additionally, an increase in global price competitiveness will result in greater exports when foreign buyers find our exports to be of better value. Finally, protectionist trade policy would cause imports to fall. If trade is opened up, it may result in greater imports and a lower value of net exports. It may, however, have the opposite effect if an opening of trade is matched by countries abroad. This is the final piece of the puzzle, and again, we simplify and set net exports fixed, explaining the straight line here for net exports. Next, we're going to put all four of these pieces together. The y-intercept of the expenditure function is the sum of all of its components when income is zero. The line is upward sloping and with a slope of less than one. It takes its slope from the consumption function's marginal propensity to consume. The 45-degree line represents all points along which aggregate expenditure and real GDP would be equal. The intersection point of the aggregate expenditure function and the 45 degree line represents equilibrium, which in this example occurs at y1. This does not necessarily correspond to full employment equilibrium. We'll explore the diagram in much greater detail in the next video on income determination. By now, you should have a better understanding of the key points listed. If you have any questions or comments on this topic, leave them below and let's try and answer them together. That's us done for now, and I will see you in the next one.